Me. Good to hear you all. Good to hear that chatter in the background. Yeah, I'd like to welcome you to the house of God, or the house of prayer. And we'll come here for a reason. I think most of us come here because we love the Lord Jesus Christ. We come to meet with him tonight in a very special way, a way that is not normal. We don't see him, we don't meet him, but it's a way where we, in our heart posture and our attitude, we can come before him. We can express it through our words that we say in our inner mind or with our spirit. We come to meet with him, we come to meet with him for a reason. We meet to be ministered to get encouragement, to encourage one another by being here. We recognise the goodness of God in our lives too. So we come here to say thank you, God, if we could, if we want to. We recognise that we live in the fallen world, and I even having a chat today with my son-in-law, Justin, and he said, where do we live in right now in this world? It is a fallen world, and ultimately we wait for the Lord's return. We wait for his coming. If he doesn't come, we've got an eternal assurance and promise that if we die, we'll be with him in eternity. That's words of encouragement tonight. That's why we're here, just to give him the glory and praise. Psalm 139, if we can open that up, please. Psalm 139, from 1 to 6. I had this in mind throughout the week, and ultimately you can read the whole lot to get the full context. Psalm 139, read it with me. And to the choir master, a psalm of David. O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from afar. You search out my path and my lying, You search out my path and my lying down, and acquired with all my ways. Even before I would even say one, let me get to my text. I think that'd be better. For there is not a word on my tongue. Behold, O Lord, you know it altogether. You have hedged me from behind and before, and you laid your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful to me. It is high, and I cannot attain it. Where can I go from your spirit? Or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend into heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in hell, behold, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the utmost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me. Your right hand shall hold me. May these words be in words of encouragement tonight to us. Let's stand up and come before the Lord in humility. Father God, we just come before you. We don't really understand. Even the psalmist says he doesn't understand. We think of something and you already know those things. How can we attain it? How do we know? But you are there. And the word of God attests to that. And we trust that and we know that. And again, as we continue and we start this service this evening, may our hearts be open to you, to meditate on your word, to be encouraged, to be challenged, Lord Jesus. We come here because we love you. Nobody's forcing us. It's our will, Father, and what a privilege it is to be here tonight, standing before your presence. As we start, may our songs be a blessing to you. May they encourage us and encourage one another. These things I pray in your precious name. Amen. We'll do a couple songs first. We'll stand as we do the two songs, and the third one we'll sit down. And I'll invite Aidan on after the third song. Please be seated, and we'll sing our next song, Blessed Assurance. It's a very old hymn that was written for this specific reason, that we have that assurance in Christ. Thank you. Thank you for leading us into worship, band.
Good evening, church. Today, I'll be reading from Psalm chapter 22, verses 1 to 18. But before I read the passage, I want to provide some context. This psalm was written by King David at least 1,000 years before Jesus' crucifixion, and it prophesies the moments leading up to Jesus' death. As we read, I want you to try and find the statements made by David that align with what Jesus experienced during his crucifixion. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me, so far from my cries of anguish? My God, I cry out by day, but you do not answer, by night, but I find no rest. Yet you are enthroned as the Holy One. You are the one Israel praises. In you our ancestors put their trust. They trusted you, and you delivered them. To you they cried out and were saved. In you they trusted and were not put to shame. But I am a worm and not a man, scorned by everyone, despised by the people. All who see me mock me. They hurl insults, shaking their heads. He trusts in the Lord, they say. Let the Lord rescue him. Let him deliver him, since he delights in him. Yet you brought me out of the womb. You made me trust in you, even at my mother's breast. From birth I was cast on you. From my mother's womb you have been my God. Do not be far from me, for trouble is near, and there is no one to help. Many bulls surround me, strong bulls of Bashan encircle me. Roaring lions that tear their prey open their mouths wide against me. I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart has turned to wax, it has melted within me. My mouth is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue sticks to the roof of my mouth. You lay in me the dust of death. Dogs surround me, and a pack of villains encircles me. They pierce my hands and my feet. All my bones are on display. People stare and gloat over me. They divide my clothes among them and cast lots for my garments. When I first read this passage, a few key verses stuck out to me. Most notably is in verse 1, my God, why have you forsaken me? Jesus recites this passage on the cross in Matthew chapter 27, verse 46. It's almost as though 2,000 years later, Jesus is telling us to come read the rest of Psalm 22. For Psalm 22 perfectly predicts the final moments of Jesus' life. In verses 7 and 8, David writes, all who see me mock me. They hurl insults, shaking their heads. He trusts in the Lord, they say. Let the Lord rescue him. These are the same words 1,000 years later being spoken to Jesus on the cross. Verse 16 reads, a pack of villains encircles me. They pierce my hands and my feet. Many historians and theologians are certain that these events did not take place upon King David, perhaps only metaphorically, and prophesied Jesus' crucifixion. The first half of this psalm is a cry out to the Lord during a time of suffering and anguish by David. There have certainly been times in my life where I can relate to feeling lost and abandoned. But in times of adversity, it is imperative that we Christians turn to the Lord with faith and trust. By my personal account, there has not been one time where I haven't sought the Lord and haven't been met with the overwhelming love and peace that he provides. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for this opportunity we all have to come and worship you. And I pray, Lord, that you continue to guide us. And as we hear today's message, we are able to just implement it into our lives, Lord. I pray that you continue to be with the people in this church. And I pray that you continue to guide and be with us always. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Thanks, Aidan, for those words that you read, spoke, and I would add nothing to it. You've done it really well. But what it does, it leads us into the next song. And let's stand up as we do the next song. Next two, above all. And after these two songs, Pastor Dane, I'll invite you to come present your message.
Above all powers, above all kings. Good evening, church. Let's hear from God's word, Luke chapter 23, verses 32 to 43. Luke chapter 23, verses 32 to 43. When they came, a little earlier, two others also who were criminals were being led away to be put to death with him. When they came to the place called the Skull, there they crucified him and the criminals, one on the right and the other on the left. But Jesus was saying, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. And they cast lots, dividing up his garments among themselves. And the people stood by, looking on. And even the rulers were sneering at him, saying, he saves others, let him save himself, if this is the Christ of God, his chosen one. The soldiers also mocked him, coming up to him, offering him sour wine, and saying, if you're the king of the Jews, save yourself. Now there was also an inscription above him, this is the king of the Jews. One of the criminals who were hanging there was hurling abuse at him, saying, are you not the Christ? Save yourself and us. But the other answered and rebuking him said, do you not even fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we are indeed are suffering justly, for we are receiving what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong. And he was saying, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus said to him, truly I say to you, today you shall be with me in paradise. Heavenly Father God, I lift this text up to you. I thank you for it, Lord, and just pray that it would do your work in our hearts this evening. Lord, whether we're saved or unsaved, God, will you be at work? I don't know what you're going to do, but I pray with all my heart that something comes of this. In Jesus' name, amen. So my sister-in-law died of cancer just a couple of weeks ago, Chochitanya, to my kids. And she was a good woman, as far as the world goes, for an unbeliever. She was extremely patient with her, bum husband a little bit like that. She was close to Nadia for a while. And she was always civil to me, although it was a little touchy, despite my capitalist leanings, being American and all. She never stopped voting for the Communist Party. And that was always kind of just a small contention between us. We didn't really make too much of it, but she never stopped. Over time, our families grew apart, mainly just due to proximity. But some 12 years back, Nadia's mother died, Mama Lita, leaving a small inheritance. That's basically an apartment of some kind. And when her three older brothers squabbled over it, we were forced to choose sides in the matter, Nadia and I, against Tanya's interests, as it turns out. After which she basically severed all ties with us and refused Nadia's overtures via Facebook Messenger for years. We couldn't contact her. And news got to us late, just a while back, that Chochitanya had terminal cancer. We didn't know how bad it was, just knew it was bad. And, we scrambled, and we asked if perchance she didn't want a brother or sister to visit her in hospice with the gospel. And either she didn't respond, or we were too late. We don't really know. Family doesn't talk too much anymore. For those of us who read their Bibles and take them seriously, what does Scripture mean when it says that unbelievers die in their sins and fall into the hands of the living God, are judged, and then pay the penalty, these are all quotes, and then pay the penalty of eternal destruction away from his presence in a place called Hades / hell. It's first Hades, and then Hades is thrown into the lake of fire. What's that mean? What's all that mean? Nadia is more hopeful than I about our Chocha Tanya. Whether there was any last minute deathbed conversion or not. But that's what love does. It hopes all things. Things turned out wonderfully differently for the thief on the cross, didn't they? Think about that. I want you to take a closer look with me at our passage, and let's color in the sketch. Okay, it's sketched for us. Let's color it in. Okay, like children. Let's be like children before the Lord. See if we can't find something to take home with us this evening. We all know the story well. We've heard it many times. Jesus leaves the upper room where he's just had his Last Supper and First Communion, which is the way to put it. He repairs to the Garden of Gethsemane for a spell to pray, where he is ultimately arrested. And Jesus is then kind of footballed around by Caiaphas, then Pilate, then Herod, then back ultimately to Pilate, which authorities, you know, spiritual and spiritual in quotations to spiritual and civil, they find absolutely no guilt in Jesus worth death, but that doesn't stop them from crucifying him anyway. For truly in this city, Acts 4, 27-28, for truly in this city there were gathered together against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed, both Herod and Pontius Pilate, along with the Gentiles and the people of Israel, to do whatever your hand and your purpose predestined to occur. It's when we read in Luke 23, verse 32, the following. Two others also, who were criminals, were being led away to be put to death with him. Criminals here. John has other men. Luke has criminals. Matthew and Mark has robbers, which is even more specific. Okay, not just other men, not just criminals, but a certain type of criminal, robbers. And everything points to the fact that these two were somehow, that they knew each other and were in cahoots, like they say. And I can't imagine what all they must have stolen to deserve the death penalty, you know, cars or something. But in Old Testament times, a desperate thief was not despised, but had to make restitution plus a percentage or something like that. Something else is going on here, right? So that's pretty lenient stuff. So something else is going on here. And these guys were what you might call career criminals, okay? Like a part of a band of thieves. And evidently the state was making an example out of them. It does kind of make you wonder, though, whether there'd be less theft today if there was capital punishment for such things, you know? Definitely, I think the crime rate would go down quickly. Verse 33, when they came to the place called the Skull. We get our word cranium from the Greek here. The Aramaic is, just so you know, kind of, you can kind of put words now in places. The Aramaic is Golgotha. Maybe you've heard that word before. The Greek is cranion, where you get cranium from. And the Latin is, I don't know how to pronounce Latin, Calvaria or something like that. The English Calvary is a transliteration of that Latin. I grew up in a church my whole life growing up. I didn't know what Calvary meant, that it meant basically like cranium or something. Like, I went to cranium church. You guys, there's no Russian churches called Lobnaya or, right? It's, don't know why we do that, but we did. Well, I guess I do know in the end, but evidently there was a hill just northeast of Old Jerusalem, if you can picture it, that looked like a skull from a certain angle. And I don't know if you want to Google this or something, you can kind of see what, you know, these these hills and kind of the rock work underneath it, and some of it's fallen out, and that kind of looks like eye sockets or whatever. You know, it's probably some, it probably would not that exact spot, but probably something like that. So it looked like a skull from a certain angle. That's where Christ and these two brigands were crucified. And so the drama's in the details here. What an artistic flourish by our great God to predestine Jesus' victory over sin and death atop this universal symbol, the skull and crossbones. I think that's interesting. It's very picturesque. Впечатляет. Let's not forget that he was crucified. Jesus was crucified. The Gospels just cover it in one verb, each of them, that he was crucified. They don't really embellish it any more than that. When they came to a place called the skull, there they crucified him. Crucifixion, of course, was a form of execution by torture. And it was about as cruel and barbaric as any deterrent dreamed by humankind. And the idea was to prolong the agony of death for all to see, and as a deterrent for others to be warned. Verse 34, but Jesus was saying, imagine this, Jesus was saying, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And this is, interestingly, not in half of the manuscripts. It's very strange this saying of Jesus, this prayer, is not there, especially in Luke. It's pretty even on both sides, the manuscript evidence. Should it be there? Should it not be there included? A few internal factors, though, point to its authenticity, that Jesus said it and that Luke wrote it, in my opinion. Because the prayer fits very seamlessly. It doesn't seem like it was interposed. And its sentiments are entirely orthodox. And also, this is the weird thing, is like Acts was also written by Luke, and it's really hard to know what to make of Stephen's prayer in Acts, where it very clearly seems like he is repeating the words of Jesus here. And so why wouldn't it also be in Luke's gospel? And there's also reasons why a copyist might have felt to, I'm going to get rid of that. Might have felt constrained to exclude it as a statement. Maybe anti-Semitism of the Marcionite kind, or maybe just the divine judgment that fell on Jerusalem in 70 AD. And then the person's left wondering, wait a second, well, then did God answer this prayer of Jesus, or did he not answer it? It's tricky. So I believe God answers Jesus' prayer here. He does not immediately destroy those responsible for crucifying the Lord of glory. I don't really know what kind of hellfire that would deserve immediately. But he will ultimately hold them responsible for their willful disobedience, willful ignorance. Lots here, look at this. They don't know what they're doing, and they cast lots, dividing up his garments among themselves. John's account is fuller, if you want to turn there with me. That's in John 19, verses 23 and 24. John 19, 23 and 24. Then the soldiers, when they had crucified Jesus, took his outer garments and made four parts, a part to every soldier, so there were four, and also the inner tunic, and also the tunic. Now the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece. So they said to one another, "Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it to decide whose it shall be." This was to fulfill the scripture, "They divided my outer garments among themselves, and for my clothing they cast lots." So four soldiers divvy up Jesus' outer garments, and probably they were ripping it proportionally to four parts. But they cast lots, or Rochambeau, or what have you, for his tunic or inner garment. Evidently, it was a seamless work of craftsmanship. They didn't want. They just said, "Oh, we're just gonna choose who does that." And we cast lots today, you guys. It's interesting. We haven't stopped. I played golf with a bunch of buddies Yesterday we had a wonderful time celebrating somebody's birthday, and we had to see who had to have all the pressure of hitting off the first tee. And what did we do? We took a zhrebi, or whatever you want to call it, and you just kind of throw it up in the air, and it spins, and this is kind of like a little arrow, and whoever it lands closest to, that guy's got to do it, right? And so it was probably just something simple like that. Like, we could just kind of go like, well, and see who preaches next week, right? But, it was something very simple like that. I don't really know exactly. They weren't rolling dice. It wasn't anything complicated. It was a real quick sort of thing. And Bach says in his commentary about this, gambling for clothes was customary at crucifixion and was the final humiliation one suffered upon execution. One died in shame and largely unclothed. This is our Lord. Verse 35, and the people stood by looking on. It's like they just yawn right there, you know, the most passive of statement. The people stood by looking on. This is why most people go to hell, by the way, for their cowardice and their passivity. For most people, the gospel doesn't even touch them, doesn't even register, even when it's happening right in front of them. And even the rulers, 35, and even, you find this phrase just constantly repeated, and even, and also. Notice how many times Luke uses these connectors. This is his way of communicating that the slights and the insults are beginning to pile up. It's like a cumulative sort of effect that he's going for here. People stood by looking on, even the rulers were sneering. We're sneering at him. This is the perfect translation. The root of this verb, ekmukterizo, that's the Greek. Mukter, the root there, means nose. And ek means from. It's a prefix that means from. So from the nose. They were from the nosing him, essentially, is what this verb means. And hence to sneer. To ridicule, and we read in Psalm 22, they separated at the lip, and then that's what happens when you sneer. Your lip goes up. Just try it. Just try to sneer, and your lip goes up. You separate at the lips, and you look down. You come at them with your nose. There was this one. I love him as a brother, and it's mainly because he lets me borrow his houseboat. In the summer when I water ski. But he used to have this way, and I don't think he knew that he had this way. This Hispanic guy, this really, you know, bigwig sort of a businessman in our area. He was also an elder. But when you would talk with him, he always was like this. And it was like he was looking down the nose at you. And he would separate at the lip with me. Let me just tell you, he would do that as well. And I'm like, oh my goodness, this guy, you know? But they're doing this to Jesus right now, all right? The leaders are doing this to Jesus, sneering at him, ridiculing. The soldiers get in on the action as well. Verse 36, the soldiers also mocked him, coming up to him, offering him sour wine. Not to be confused with wine mixed with gall, which is more powerful. This is sour wine. This is the stuff that guys would probably drink every day that were out working. It's very kind of low alcohol content. And this is whatever they had around with them. And the Greek here is empaizo. And the root there has like childish atienki. It's the word means child. The root means child. It's like they were teasing him, probably with the drink, you know, because Jesus is thirsty. I don't really know what to make of their taunts, whether they're stupid, racist, or both. I don't really know. I don't think they know what they're talking about. This is all, это все по-детски. And this is not very smart. They're not very smart, these guys. Yeah. Childish behavior. Take it from me, as a former elementary school teacher, kids do know how to tease. They're really good at this. And this is, again, in the Greek, the whole, the wagging of the head. You know what I mean? That sort of a thing. Just, you know, it's kind of pathetic at this point. Now, there was an inscription above him. This is the King of the Jews. An inscription, this inscription here was a placard. It was fixed above the one crucified. May have been something above the robbers. So you know they're robbers as well, because that's what it said. They're robbers. Okay, the placard usually stated the charge, all right, to deter such behavior in the future. This is what you do, this is what you get. This one here is the King of the Jews, or something like that, hung above Jesus' head. And it was written, it was trilingual, it was written in three languages, the local, universal, and official language, or Aramaic and Greek and Latin. So it must have been, I don't know, it must have been kind of big. And it was there for all who could read. Even one of the crucified crooks gets a dig in. The irony is just so palpable here. One of the criminals who were hanged there was hurling abuse at him. Blaspheming was the word. Okay, be careful when you take Jesus' name on your lips. So if you say something against him, right, it's more than just ridicule, it's blasphemy. One of the criminals who were hanged there was blaspheming, saying, aren't you the Christ? Well, save yourself and us. The irony is just palpable. To sarcastically ask Jesus to save you at this point, as if it wasn't exactly what Jesus was doing. Paying the price for others. But the other, and this is the point. But the other answered and rebuking him said, do you not even fear God? And the idea is like, are you not the Christ? And he's looking at the other, the first thief is looking at the second thief, like, oh hey, you want to get on this? Are you not the Christ? And that other thief defends Jesus at that point. It's interesting. The other synoptists make no mention of the second thief's conversion. Strange. I would really want to tell people about that. They don't. Matthew and Mark, they lump the two together as participating in teasing Jesus, which may have been the case at first. I kind of doubt it. I just think that a lot of times when the gospel writers are talking, if they want, they can say something general, and then the specific part you have to kind of bring in later and say, okay, this is kind of, they just didn't want to talk about that, and so they were kind of general with it. But you don't know. Maybe he initially was participating. Either Matthew and Mark, they don't know about this man's change of heart, or it was superfluous to what they were trying to say, the point they were trying to make. It doesn't really matter. Thanks to Luke, now you know the rest of the story. Second thief does not condone the first's ridicule. Instead of joining in, the second thief basically asks the first whether he has a conscience whatsoever. Do you not have any conscience? They have been rightly charged and punished, both of them. This man here in between them, he hasn't done anything wrong. And the word there, wrong, means out of place. So forget even sinning, never sinning. Jesus never did anything remotely out of step. And he was saying, Jesus, 42, he was saying, Jesus, remember me when you come in your kingdom. This is an intensely personal statement. Only the penitent thief, out of all bystanders, calls Jesus by name. Only one. And it's true that salvation requires a personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. And this happens through him indwelling believers by his Spirit. It's a very close, personal thing. We pray Jesus. Through him we pray, Abba, Father. Remember me when you come in your kingdom, or into your kingdom. Again, there's another textual issue here which we won't get into. It's probably not too smart to read too much into a dying man's eschatology anyway. Point is that he sides with Jesus. And Jesus said to him, truly I say to you, today you shall be with me in paradise. And without drawing you a detailed map of the netherworld, a la Dante's Inferno, I should probably tell you what I think is going on here. The Old Testament has kind of a fuzzy understanding of what happens after people die, and there's a lot of talk of Sheol, which is understood as the grave, or even deeper, the netherworld. And this same idea or sentiment is also in Greek thought, and basically Hades in the New Testament and Sheol in the Old Testament, so New Testament Greek Hades and Old Testament Hebrew Sheol, are very similar. It's a disembodied sort of slow, mirage, sort of existence, spirit world. It's located probably not physically, right, but like we would think in terms of dimensions below. And there are levels of Sheol and or Hades. There's the lower and the upper, according to I think it's chapter 16 of Luke. There is lower Sheol where the rich man is calling out, and Lazarus is in Abraham's bosom above. And basically, what I believe happens, I'm not the only one, a lot do. When Jesus dies, he enters the spirit world. He comes alive in the spirit. I preached on this. And he goes down to Hades, and he preaches victory. And he takes with him captives and takes them up to heaven. He takes Upper Sheol with him. He takes Abraham's bosom with him and takes him up, and it's paradise is now in heaven, such that when you die, to be absent from the body is to be immediately with the Lord. And this is what he's saying. He says, today you will be with me in paradise, because that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to go down there. I'm going to take upper Sheol with me, Abraham's bosom, and take you all up to the very presence of God. And for some reason that wasn't immediately accessible, because Christ had not yet died for sin. Something like that. That's what I think. But either way, an amazing promise. This guy is, we don't say it, but this guy is just like so lucky. I'm sorry. We don't like to use that word. But, you know, sometimes, you know, we're so lucky what God has for us. You know that sort of thing. What in the world is this guy doing getting saved at the last second like this? What gracious words from our Savior's parched lips. Today you shall be with me in paradise. A very fortuitous and undeserved outcome for this second thief. Someone once said, I believe it was Augustine, I'm pretty sure. There is one deathbed conversion in the Gospels to give us hope, and only one to give us pause. That's a 1,700-year-old mic drop right there. Nothing better has ever been said about this passage of Scripture. The moral of this story and lesson for us this evening cannot be any clearer. Listen to it again. There is one deathbed conversion in the Gospels to give us hope, and only one to give us pause. Not to presume. The beauty of this passage is on display for all to behold who read it. I'm especially talking about the gracious way that Jesus endures crucifixion on our behalf. It's why I love him. It's why I follow him with my life. But it's really only meant to minister to us a couple ways, depending on whether, just kind of where you're at with the Lord, whether you're saved or not. For those of us who are saved, this vignette encourages us to hope against hope. For those unbelieving family members and friends who are ours, who do not yet know Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior, and who just, through our prayers, may escape by the skin of their teeth, as we say, encourages us to hope. Believers go where they don't deserve. Unbelievers go where they do. But for those of us who aren't saved and who are going where we do deserve, it warns us not to presume. Do not presume that this is the normal way God in Christ operates. Fancifully saving unbelievers as they breathe their last. Hope all things. Hope all things, Nadia. This passage is all about deathbed conversions. Brands snatched from the fire at the last second and in the nick of time, like that. Take heart that it ain't over until it's over. Some of us I know are hoping against hope, counting on this very possibility with some of our more belligerent close relatives and loved ones. I stopped buying packs of peanuts because too often I would get to one, just like the shell, there it was no breaking it. There's no breaking into that peanut shell to get that peanut. Some people are just tough nuts to crack. I swear I almost broke my leg trying to stomp on it to get it. There's people like that that we can't give up hope on. If ever there was an example of how salvation is a free gift to all who believe, it's this guy here. All this guy did was believe in his heart and confess with his mouth, and bada bing, bada bang, he's in like Flynn with Jesus. For by grace, I repeat this often, but it's just such a great verse. For by grace you've been saved. You know, basically God's good fortune to you. By grace you have been saved through faith. It's not of yourselves. It's the gift of God. Not as a result of works. He's not looking to see who'd earned this or not. That no one should boast. Thief 2 is proof positive that it doesn't matter who, doesn't matter when, the righteousness of Christ has made a way for us all. Merciful Jesus, deathbed conversions do happen. So believer, take hope and be ready to jump at the chance. Never give up. They do happen, but they don't happen often. Okay? Last point. They don't happen often. So, dearest unbeliever, if you are here with us this evening, don't presume anything. Presume nothing. The reason we're drawn to this text in the first place is because it's so unusual. This is rarely how things go down. Please understand that your life is but, the Bible says, a hand's breadth. Your days are like a passing shadow. Here today, gone tomorrow. You aren't a single grain in the sands of time. You don't know what tomorrow may bring. You aren't even promised a tomorrow. But say tomorrow does come. Say it comes. And the next. And the next day. Here's something else you're not promised. To be so fortunate as to die slowly right next to the Savior of mankind and the greatest evangelist to have ever lived. Get a front row seat like that. Is that your backup plan? I want to know. That's your backup plan? That sounds foolish to me. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. And seek the Lord while he may still be found. Quit dragging your feet. Why play with the prospect of redemption and eternal life like that? Who's to say God doesn't harden your heart toward spiritual things? Who's to say he doesn't do that for rejecting him in the first place? You think you're always going to be so like warmly predisposed to spiritual things and the gospel and Jesus? No, that's not how it works either. You delay your decision to follow Christ at your own peril. What's keeping you? Follow thief number two's example. And seize this moment like it was your last. And I've got more to say. But I want all of us to stand right now. Stand with me and pray with me. For whoever is on your mind who doesn't yet know Jesus and is going to a place that they well deserve. You know what I mean. I'm going to leave it open for a couple of us to pray. Let's not name names, but let's pray more generally. And then I'll close. Heavenly Father, God, I've gone too long. Your people are tired. But I know that they know of whom I speak, and it's heavy on their hearts because it's heavy on mine. God, reach these people that we love before it's too late. For their own sakes, for your glory, and in your name. Amen.
Just remain standing. We'll just finish off with one reading. Romans 8, 28, 29. Let's read it together when you get a chance. Romans 8, 38 and 39. Thank you. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Father, as we finish off this evening service, you know the heaviness of our hearts, the pupil that we have on our minds at this moment. May we not tire just to pray for them, commit them to you, Father. And again, bless this week as we go forward, as we have time of fellowship in the hall, sharing life over a cup of tea or food to eat. May we not tire or forget these precious people in our lives. Amen.